All right, well, good morning. And it is week 10, Wednesday. And this is our last lecture, I think, right? Yeah, because Friday you'll have your final exam. And yeah, that's it. So this is our last time together. So thanks for being here, all 9 of you, 10 of you. I don't know. I feel like I did this in 102A. I don't know. I'm just giving some unsolicited advice. You didn't ask for this. And I don't know if this is going to be helpful at all or not. My hope is that it can be a little bit helpful. And I've titled this Unsolicited Advice for People About to Enter the Workforce. So some of you, I think most of you are seniors and you're gonna be graduating and like in June, right? And then you'll start working. That's probably a lot of you. Some of you will still go to school, will, you know, return to grad school, but a lot of you will start working, and eventually, even if you go to grad school, eventually you'll start working. And so, you know, I think these points will still remain true and whatnot. And it's been a while since I've worked in quote industry, but I think, I don't know what I say, applies still to like my job now and jobs in industry. And I do talk to people in industry and just talk about, I don't know what they look for in their candidates, and you know what gets them promoted and whatnot. Okay, so anyway, I start off with congratulations, you have a job. So this is assuming you got your job, okay? And I know that's a process and that's a journey and that's a struggle. And I don't have, I guess I had. I have other advice for that, but that one is just kind of, you know, throwing your application out there, and you know, I don't have, you know, there's lots of other advice out there for like how to do well on your interview and things like that. But okay, this is all about making the most of your job. Okay, and so the following slides is full of unsolicited advice from me about making the most of your job. I hope it's helpful. Take everything with a grain of salt. You know, who knows? Maybe I have no idea what I'm talking about. But okay. And then the other bit, just a tiny bit of perspective. So, you know, I'll be telling you about like getting ahead in your job and whatnot. But it's always good to just take a step back and just remember that your life, okay, is much more than just going to work and making money, okay? A large portion of your time is going to be doing work and whatnot. But yeah, sometimes a job is just a job, okay? Sometimes it's just a way for you to earn money so that you can pay the bills and you can live the rest of your life. And that might be you know, having a family or pursuing interests that are interesting to you, or you know, helping other people out or something like that, okay? Sometimes you are in a good place and your job is satisfying and fulfilling, okay? And that's great. That's my hope for each of you, but not everybody is super lucky to end up finding that, okay? And that's okay, all right? Like, my father never had a job, like, during his working years that he, like, loved and found satisfying and fulfilling. Like, he worked all kinds of different, like, sales positions, and, like, he was good at it, and he made money, but it wasn't, like, that was his passion that brought him joy and fulfillment. And I don't think he would have any regrets, okay? If you find a job that's satisfying, fulfilling, that's great and that's wonderful. but not everybody has that, and that's okay, okay? It's just one aspect of your life. Whether it is satisfying and fulfilling, it is still just one aspect of your life. Your life is so much more than just that time you spend at work, okay? And I tell you, in school, you are not defined by your grades. Your grades do not define who you are. And then once you are in the workplace, okay, your title and your income are not going to define who you are, all right? That's, I don't know, sometimes there's a bit of a measuring contest. It feels that way, you know, when you go to a dinner party and you meet other people and they ask, oh, so what do you do? And you feel like you have to give some kind of answer that's going to sound impressive or things like that. You know, that's okay. You don't have to. You are not defined by your title and income, okay? Yeah. And some of you, you know, depending on life circumstances, may become like, you know, a stay-at-home parent or things like that. And that is totally, that's great. If you have that opportunity where you have a partner that, you know, earns enough income to support everybody, you know, that's great. You know, you can find joy you know, being at home, all right? So, but anyway, this is all about, you know, under the assumption that you're at work and, I don't know, you want to do well or something. Okay, so some of this is just cheesy advice, but you know, have a good attitude and be professional. It sounds basic, but I think it's I think it goes a long way. All right, you know, there's this thing about growth mindset. All right, there's always, you know, sometimes the tasks that you'll be given are going to be mundane, repetitive, boring, or tedious. Okay. Even then, everything is an opportunity to learn, even if it is, you know, it feels beneath you or whatever, okay? Like, you might get a data analyst job, okay, and then you find out your job is more like data entry and data cleaning, okay? That's actually still a huge part. Data cleaning is still a huge part of your job, whether you're at, you know, data analyst or data scientist or things like that, and it's time consuming, you know, you might be able to automate it. You might be able to think creatively and find, you know, scripts to automate things. You know, there's a bunch of stuff. Maybe you have to like go to all of these different sources around the internet and pull information, but you might, maybe you can write little web scripts to download and things like that. You know, depending on where you are, it can feel frustrating being given, you know, dumb little tasks, but a lot of times you can make something interesting out of it, okay? You know, be proactive. Depending on what job you have, there might be times where your direct manager, your supervisor might not have a task for you to work on right away, okay? And if you can just be thinking ahead and just say like, hey, you know what, I noticed here's a need and nobody has said anything about it, okay? And you can try proposing something new or something. You know, there's a bit of reading when something is appropriate to bring up something new like that, but that's good, okay? Feedback, sometimes, it says accept constructive criticism. Sometimes it'll just feel like criticism, okay? But again, if you can have a good attitude where, you know, somebody can tell you like where you can make corrections or what you didn't do well or something like that. If you can accept that graciously, you know, people like that. Okay. And if you can use that to improve, you know, so seek out feedback from your colleagues and supervisors, right? And then finally, be reliable. So as much as you can, meet deadlines. And if you notice something's going to be delayed, communicate that early. Don't try to hide problems or things like that, okay? Follow through on any kind of commitments. Delays happen, things get messed up. Just be clear and upfront rather than try to kind of hide and pretend like things are okay. So that's just kind of a little bit of just general attitude and professionalism advice here. Okay. All right. Here's now we're starting to get into, I think, my opinions regarding some of this. And so this one is, I titled, Know Who You Have to Keep Happy, all right? And so I said, identify the key players in that at work, there are going to be certain people whose opinions matter, and then there's everyone else, okay? And so who is going to be in charge of whether you get a promotion or not, okay? Who's gonna be in charge of, you know, your bonus, your performance evaluations, things like that? Those are the people that matter. Generally, this person is gonna be your supervisor, your manager, okay? But there might be other stakeholders. There might be, you know, your manager's manager, okay? Or some other person that has a say in these kinds of decisions, right? So, and those are the people you need to keep happy more than, you know, if you're part of a team, your colleagues, their opinions might not matter as much, okay? Of course, you don't wanna make enemies or things like that. You don't wanna cause problems, but you gotta think about who's going to be making those kinds of decisions. And so you wanna know what is important to them and what success looks like from their perspective. If success from their perspective is, seeing sales numbers grow, then that needs to become your priority too, okay? If success to them is just seeing you on time at work, right? And you know, some people, like, punctuality is really important to them, and other people punctuality, like, they don't care, okay? You gotta figure out, like, what's important, right? And so if it's like showing up at on time is important to that person, then show up on time or early. They like that, okay? But if it doesn't matter, then it doesn't matter, all right? So try to figure out what what success looks like from their perspective. It's not necessarily the things that you find important, right? And I feel a little bit terrible saying this, but you know, you're gonna be going in with this statistics knowledge, and you might know that, like, there are better statistical techniques or better statistical approaches to a certain problem, okay? But your manager might feel like this is the approach we wanna take, and you gotta keep your manager happy, all right? If you wanna take a different approach, don't just take the different approach, all right? Do what your manager asks you first, and then make, like, if you really feel like something else is gonna be much better, you have to get your manager on board. You have to get your manager to kind of see things the way you do, rather than just, like, doing something else and saying, like, and then trying to argue, like, oh, isn't this better? First make them happy, then then you try to work on convincing to change them. And I had to kind of learn that the hard way, in that, like, you know, I thought, like, you know, of course this way is better, but my opinion didn't matter as far as, like, being a, you know, like, one of the youngest employees there. You know, know who you got to keep happy, know what they want, and then at least, you know, pretend to go along with whatever they think is important, all right? Okay, going along with that, communicate effectively, right? So if they said, hey, this is important and I want updates, provide them regular updates with that specific topic or things like that, okay? So once you know what they think is important, give them updates on whatever that thing is, okay? And nobody likes reading huge, long paragraphs. So keep all of your updates short and concise. Like, we are on track, or we are falling behind, or we're ahead of schedule, right? Just like things like that, okay? And then, you know, be a team player. Think about what's important to you. Obviously, pursue your individual goals, but help out your colleagues if you can. This is also really important, okay? Don't speak poorly about any of your colleagues behind their back, because and sometimes it's so tempting when if other people in the office are complaining about somebody. It's just a natural thing to want to kind of like join the group opinion and things. And you know, if other people are complaining about someone, you know, and they say, hey, you know, what do you think about so and so? You just go, oh, I don't know. Right? Don't try not to speak poorly. Okay. And then even going along with that, if you have anything negative to say, don't ever put it in writing. Okay. Don't ever write an email that says so-and-so sucks, okay? If you want to complain to your manager about something, like if you have a legitimate problem with someone, try to do it verbally, okay? Rather than put it in an email, okay? Unless it's like, I don't want to get in trouble, but... unless you're like trying to create a paper trail of like this is an actual like, I don't want to say crime or like fraudulent something, and you want to create a paper trail to cover your tracks and things like that, cover yourself, then that's when you put things in writing. But if it's just kind of like a personality thing, like someone's annoying you, generally speaking, keep it verbal, because things can happen and suddenly this person that you were speaking ill about now is in a position of power over you, okay? Sometimes that happens. And then if there's a paper trail, then, you know, things are, yeah. So anyway, that's how I feel, okay? Again, my opinions. All right. And then the other is administrative assistants. Administrative assistants in the office, I think these are kind of underrated, undervalued, and yet they actually have so much power. So admin assistants are basically, you know, every office, every department, they have some administrative assistant who's responsible for stuff like scheduling resources, sending out memos, coordinating meetings, those kinds of like day-to-day logistics, right? And these people don't have, quote, official authority. They're not in charge of, you know, promotions or a lot of these kinds of decisions and stuff. But they do have a lot of kind of informal influence, and they can serve as like gatekeepers, especially to upper management and things like that. So I think it's really important to stay on the good side of all of these administrative assistants, okay? And it's, you know, stuff like saying thank you anytime they do a task for them, right? I feel like I've seen so many times where, you know, a person kind of makes demands of the administrative assistant because technically they're like ranked higher in the company, so they feel like they can just kind of boss the administrative assistant around and say, hey, I need you to do this for me, and then and that's it. I'd say, you know, show all of them a lot of appreciation for what they do, okay? Anytime you do have a request of the admin assistant, okay, be clear and organized, all right? Try to make your requests as clear as possible. It's better to have preferences rather than say, oh, this, it doesn't matter, you figure it out, right? Like, it doesn't, like, oh, anything is fine, is actually like frustrating for these people who have to kind of fill out these forms, because then it's like, well, I don't know what to do, right? So make your choices. Obviously, if they say, hey, you know, I can't get this for you, you know, be flexible, all right? So, but anyway, build a positive relationship, and then the things that annoy admin assistants the most are like last minute requests where you're like, oh no, I need this done right away. Those are the things that that are annoying. Okay, however, that said, if you do keep the administrative assistants happy, and you do have an urgent request, okay, it having a good relationship with the admin assistant, so let's say you have an urgent request where it's like, you know, I'd like to schedule a meeting with a senior executive, okay? If the admin assistant doesn't like you, they'll just say, sorry, they're not available, okay? Versus if the admin assistant does like you, they might go out of the way and say, hey, you know what? I can find this, you know, here's a block of time that that's available, right? I can, or they'll say like, oh, you know what? A spot just opened up and I can slide you in, and they'll let you know about those kinds of things. Know your admin assistants, know who you got to keep happy, right? And I think that's someone you should do, okay? I don't know. All right. So once you know who you got to kind of keep happy and impress, you know, how do you then stand out in your role? All right. Obviously, you know, knowing, you know, being good at your job, that's going to go far, right? You know, try to keep learning stuff. There's new technologies always kind of going out there. Lots of resources. There's only so much you can learn in university where you get a good foundation, and then, you know, keep learning. Keep learning on the job. Don't get kind of, you know, just stuck in doing what you're comfortable doing, okay? If there is something where you're able to kind of go above and beyond what was asked, do it, right? You know, add a little bit of extra value if you can. Think, you know, say like, hey, you know what? I think this would be useful. Things like that. Solve. You know, problems as you see them, right? And so kind of going along with that is basically learning the business. Become an expert in whatever it is, you know, your company is doing. So, you know, understand what the, I guess, organization's goals. Understand that kind of thing, and try to meet that need. And so a lot of it is, I guess this just goes along with like, be good at your job, but I don't know. In some of my other classes, and I say like, if you do some kind of data related project, I always say like, pick a data set that you're knowledgeable about. Okay, and whatever data you're dealing with at the company, and I guess I'm assuming you're dealing with some kind of data-related job, but even if you're not in a data-related job, like just kind of knowing the ins and outs of your business, okay, and what, like if you're producing dashboards and reports and things like that, knowing how these things will be used, what decisions will be made from them, will be able to help you create something that is going to be useful. Like if you can kind of anticipate and predict how it might be used or wanted, you're able to kind of produce reports or visualizations or whatever is needed to address those things. So, rather than just doing what was asked of you, right? Doing the kind of minimum to meet the checklist versus, going above and beyond. So that's what I think. All right. All right. So, I don't know. Not that promotions are the end goal of everything, but that is, I think, I think it should be a goal, until you're in a spot that you are happy with where you say like, all right, I don't want to move any higher than this. Okay. So as much as possible, okay, do your best to deliver high quality work. Okay. If your manager says, hey, we're in a time crunch and we just need it done, sure, then just get it done. Okay. But do your work high quality. Pretend like everything you're going to turn in is going to become part of this portfolio that you're building for presenting and saying, this is why I'm worthy of promotion. Okay. Sometimes on Campus Wire, I see students asking, like, do you think, do I need to do this, right? Or the question essentially boils down to, what's the minimum I need to do to get the points on the on the homework problem, right? That's essentially what it, and I would say that's not the right attitude to take, right? It's always kind of just like, it should be, what's the highest quality work that I can do in this scenario, all right? Obviously, there's a balance between like, I need to get this done, I don't have unlimited time and energy, but as much as you can, these are the kinds of things that I think will make a difference, all right? Develop your soft skills. I've got more slides on soft skills, and I think, in my opinion, those are the things that are actually even more important than your technical skills, all right? There are going to be a lot of times where somebody who is not at, like, if there's two people, right? And one person has better technical skills than the other, but the other person has much better softer skills than the other, usually the person who has the better softer skills will get chosen for promotion and advancement. Like those things I find often count more towards those kinds of things. Okay. Another thing is track your achievements. All right. Write down and keep a note of what you've done and what you've contributed, okay? Because no one else is gonna keep track of these things for you, right? They might remember like, oh yeah, you did a good job on this one project, okay? But beyond that one project, you've probably worked on a whole bunch of other things. And so you wanna kind of have all of that ready to be able to say like, this is how I am important and useful, okay? And going along with that, update your resume and or LinkedIn profile regularly with kind of your contributions, right? No one's going to be advocating for yourself like you yourself. You have to be your own best advocate and say, I'm important and this is how I'm achieving things, okay? And then, as you see fit, seek out opportunities to kind of stretch yourself and ask your manager, whatever, to put you in kind of the certain leadership roles or things like that, within a, after you've been working for a year or two, and someone new gets hired after you, all right, volunteer and say, hey, I'm happy to, show them the ropes. I'm happy to, act as a mentor and things like that to these, junior colleagues, or, when you feel comfortable leading a project, don't hesitate to step up for that. Okay. All right. So as far as, soft skills go, I think the big ones are, I would say, leadership, collaboration, communication, technical proficiency. Sure, that's great. Okay. But I would say soft skills are really going to, I'd say technical skills get you in the door, and then your soft skills move you up. All right. That's my opinion. Okay. So whatever projects you're on, take ownership. Even if you're not officially the lead, all right, approach all of your tasks with accountability. You want to make sure you're the tasks get done, and things like that, right? So, if your team is stuck waiting for something, okay, take the initiative to follow up or find a workaround in the meantime or something like that. Okay. Smaller initiatives onboarding a new hire, things like that. Or even just small things like organizing a team meeting, these kinds of things. Volunteer for these small things. And if you do well with the small tasks, then you'll be entrusted with bigger ones. Okay. And then whenever possible, offer solutions to problems you identify. All right. So yes, very important to say, hey, this is an issue I've noticed. Okay. This is something that, I'm noticing is, an issue that we should try to fix. This is, if you're able to, and you're able to say like, hey, this is how I think we can fix it. All right. Offer solutions and stuff like that. Okay. Having empathy as a leader will make people want to be happy to, I guess, have you as their leader, right? Understand what's important to different individuals on your team. Different individuals on your team. They've got different motivations, right? And if some people are motivated by, different kinds of recognition, use that, okay? Use that, right? If obviously, everybody wants increased salary and pay, right? And that might not be within your control, right? So they say, I feel valued if you pay me more. Obviously, that's what everybody wants. And yes, if you're able to do that, then that's great. But other ways, okay, people probably won't feel valued if you give them a pizza party. Okay, sure, it's nice, but that's usually not what's it, right? If you can figure out something that they would actually appreciate, like an extra day off or something, that you are able to kind of accommodate, figure that out. That's going to be good. Okay. Obviously, yes, paying people more. That's usually does the trick for a lot of things, but not always. And that might not always be your within your control. Okay. Being a team player and collaborating. Every team you're on is going to be different. Kind of be sensitive to different kind of team dynamics, and you might have to find yourself adjusting to complement others. Some of these things are going to come easier to some than others, right? And that's fine. You don't have to just completely change who you are every single time. This is what I think. All right. You're probably going to have to work with a lot of other people from different departments that have different skill sets, and listen to what they have to say, right? I'm assuming you're going to be probably coming in from like the data side of things, and the people you're working with might be completely ignorant about data related stuff. That doesn't mean that their opinions are not important, okay? They're going to bring in, you know, different viewpoints. Listen, you don't necessarily have to do exactly what they say, but I always feel like you can learn from someone else, right? I have this spelled wrong. Be friendly, approachable. I don't know. I feel like it goes a long way. All right. And then the other part is, can you? I don't know. This formatting got all weird. Can you communicate well? Right. So one of the biggest tasks coming from the data side is a lot of times we have knowledge and stuff, and other people don't have the same kind of background technical expertise. So you have to simplify a lot of these things and a lot of your explanations so that they can make sense of it, okay? So, and this might mean editorializing your findings, okay? And this often makes statisticians and data scientists a little bit uncomfortable, because a lot of times we just feel like, let the data speak for itself, and I don't want to add my opinions to, right? I just want to present the data as it is. And that is great in an ideal world and things like that, but eventually, okay, you have to make an opinion or have an opinion on like what this means and what actions should be taken. And so, you know, unless your manager tells you not to do this, you can argue, because basically, I think what you can find frustrating is, because you might feel like, oh, I don't want to editorialize, right? And I just want to always kind of present the data as, this is what the data says, this is kind of the truth. But the thing is the people who make decisions, even though the data is coming in and you're saying this is the truth, they just see it as your opinion, okay? Right? And then they hear other people, and everybody's got their opinions, okay? And even though your opinion is backed up by the data, so you feel like this is really, like, this is not my opinion, this is like the truth, okay? The people making decisions, they're just hearing everybody, and then they're just saying like, oh, well, that's the data department's opinion. But, so they're gonna perceive your statement as an opinion anyway. So I think it's okay to kind of insert your opinion in here, right? So you can say, hey, so instead of just saying something like the model has an 85% F1 score, all right? Okay, which is just gonna be the truth statement, all right? That's gonna be what it is. You can say something like, our predictions have an F1 score of 85%, and then you throw this part in, which is gonna make it easier for someone who has no idea what F1 actually means, okay? And just say, which means in this case, it's reliable for decision making, right? And that's just like a little extra tidbit, maybe your opinion, right? Because somebody else might say like, oh no, 85% is not high enough. But you might say like, no, this is actually pretty good. This is better than any of the other models. This is the best one we have. I think it's okay to say that. And this is gonna make it easier for the decision makers to digest, right? Rather than just saying 85%, is that good or bad? Tell them that's good. and that's that, okay? Obviously, know your audience. Know if you're presenting to engineers who know all of this stuff versus presenting to kind of executives who just kind of want a summary. You know, tailor your presentations like that. And then this part, use storytelling. I think this is how you get your point across, right? You have your data. But try to fit it into a narrative that ultimately leads to kind of a point, right? It's You know, keep it as part of a story and frame your findings in that narrative rather than just presenting here's, you know, some dry facts, okay? A little bit of weaving there. Okay, and then in this slide, this one's the tough one. Sometimes you'll find it's time to change jobs, okay? And I think that's okay. You don't, ultimately, an employee's relationship to a company is transactional, okay? You give them your time and energy, they give you money. That's generally how it is. You don't owe some company your loyalty or things like that. Now, companies might try to incentivize your loyalty by saying, we have this stock ownership plan and you have to stay here for 6 years to become fully vested or things like that, okay? And then and they might try to buy your loyalty with money. And that's fine, okay? If financially if that makes sense, then that's great, right? Like that's one. Well, first of all, I love working at UCLA. It's so great, but they've also really incentivized like your loyalty as an employee by saying like the longer you stay here, like you're gonna get like your retirement values like go up. Like every year you stay, like it goes up and up and up. So it's like I feel like even if I got another job offer, I feel like oh, I'm walking away from like all of this. so they've incentivized loyalty. And so, you know, some companies might do that, but at the end of the day, it's just, I feel like your employee relationship to a company is really transactional. Okay. Unless you're like best friends with the CEO or unless this is a company that really, you know, maybe it's a nonprofit and it's got this kind of, belief that you truly believe in, all right, sure, that's great. But most other kind of for-profit places, it's this trend thing, all right? So don't feel bad, okay? Don't feel bad changing careers, changing jobs. That's happens all the time, okay? And if you see like there's no longer opportunities for you to grow or learn new skills, okay? Maybe it's time to consider a move, right? If you've been in the same role for a few years and there's no clear path for advancement, okay, maybe you know, you can explore other options, okay? Other things that factor in, just your own satisfaction in the job, okay? If your work environment becomes toxic, okay, you know, prioritize your well-being. Things can happen, and you know, the toxic environment might not be worth whatever money they're paying you. You know, there's no sense earning a lot of money if you can't enjoy your life. Okay. Other things, and this one's a little bit tougher, right? You know, pay attention to the rest of the industry, and if you feel like, oh man, this place I'm working for is not adapting or changing or adapting kind of best practices and things like that, you might want to look at other organizations and stuff, okay? And so, you know, using all of that, all of the stuff that you would use towards getting a promotion within your company, also work towards getting a better position at a new place, okay? You know, try not to burn bridges if you don't have to, because the same people, like sometimes an organization just kind of like starts going down and everybody starts exiting at the same time, okay? And so as people leave, keep those connections, because they might say like, hey, I'm at this new place and it's great. And you know, they can get you a foot in the door there, okay? So it's okay. It's okay to change jobs, right? I don't think we're at this time. There used to be a time where it was like, why do you have like 4 jobs in the last 5 years, and that looks like a bad thing, okay? And obviously, like, constantly changing your jobs, probably not great, but oftentimes, every time you change jobs, it comes with a significant salary increase. Otherwise, people won't change their job, okay? Because it's always easier to just not go through change. but anyway, that's that. Okay. And then this is just miscellaneous stuff, all right? I'd say stay up to date on trends, okay? You know, data science, this is constantly updating. You know, read blogs, attend different little webinars or whatever, go to conferences, you know. Well, conferences are expensive, so go if your company's willing to send you. But say, hey, you know what, I want to stay up to date on the trends, okay? Take online courses, those kinds of things. I went to the Python conference earlier this year, and I felt like, oh man, there's like so much new stuff that's happening, and it's exciting, and I want to go again next year, and things like that. So that's great. All right. Mentors, if you find an individual who's able and willing to mentor you, often they can be a great resource, okay? Different professional communities can be a place where you can find mentors or just learn stuff, all right? And then always, I always am an advocate of work-life balance, and so just make sure you have other things in life outside of work that keep you happy and healthy, all right? Set boundaries, and hopefully you can find a place, a workplace, where having those boundaries is seen as a good thing and not a bad thing. Okay, so anyway, thanks for hearing me out on my unsolicited advice at the workplace. So anyway, that's it. I wrote, good luck out there. I'm so proud of each one of you, and this is totally true. Some of you took like a bunch of classes with me, and I am honored that you chose to enroll in my class. And so I hope you've enjoyed 102C. Connect with me on LinkedIn if we're not already connected. I think course evaluations are open, and I think they close like Saturday, like 8 a.m. or something. So I appreciate your evaluations, because they do count in like my merit reviews. So, you know, there's no promotion, but there's like salary bumps. They call them merit reviews. And so, you know, they look at those numbers. And so anyway, I appreciate you leaving a review there. Anyway, that's it. Good luck, I guess, career-wise, but also as you prepare for the final on Friday. And I guess we'll see you then. All right, thanks, everybody.